If you have your Bibles with you today, let's turn to Romans chapter 8, Romans chapter 8, verses 9 through 11, Romans chapter 8, verses 9 through 11, and we're going to wrap up a discussion this morning that we have been in for a couple of weeks now as we have been talking about this battle for our minds, the battle for our minds, and we're going to wrap up this discussion this morning, and then I think the plan is, I think we're going to hit pause in Romans for a little while and move on into some holiday things, and then at the start of the new year, we will pick up here in the second half of the book of Romans, chapter number 8, and work our way out from there. And I hope it's not been a daunting task for you. I hope it's not been something that you have grown weary of. I have really, really enjoyed the book of Romans, and it's been good for me. And as I said at the start, I think in many ways it's the most important series I've ever preached in 20 years of ministry. I hope it's been good for you. It's been really good for me. But we're going to take a small little pause in this holiday season and do some other things. And then at the start of the year, we will start something. We will come back to the book of Romans. But we've been in this series on the battle for our minds over the last couple of weeks, and specifically about setting our minds on the things of the Spirit and how that is contrasted against setting our minds on the things of the flesh. In the first week, you'll recall that we were given an admonition, or we were given a charge, and that is that we are told that the location of our greatest struggle is in our mind, and therefore we are to set our minds on the things that are above, set our minds on the things of the Spirit and not the things of the flesh. That is, that the apostle has told us that our greatest struggle is not the one that is played out in the world, in the cosmos, in our culture, but our greatest struggle is the one that's played out in here, right? And the war we wage is the one where we have to change our thinking. And to that end, the apostle reminded the people of Rome what we should be thinking about at the start of Romans chapter 8, that we are to set our minds specifically on the gospel, that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus because Christ became sin so that we might become the righteousness of God in his place and be accepted by God. And because of that, because of that change in thinking, that we set our minds on the gospel, that means that we are to set our minds on the things of the Spirit, which he contrasts against the things of the flesh. We've talked about the things of the flesh and how those are the things that are against the things of the Spirit. Or in other words, that the things of the flesh that Paul has in mind here are the things which are not pleasing to God. And then therefore, the things of the Spirit of God are those things which are given to us as a result or end of our expressed faith in Jesus Christ. When we express faith in Jesus Christ, we were each given the Spirit of God, a point that we're going to return to this morning. And because that Spirit of God lives in us, that we should walk in the presence of God in all things and at all times. And the things of the flesh, those things which are not God-like, are inconsistent with who God is. Those things that are not consistent with the Spirit of God who lives in us. Those things which are not pleasing to God. Those things we are not to focus our attention on. But because the Spirit of God lives in us, we are to set our mind on those things which indeed please God. Last week, we were given a warning. It's not a game that we somehow play. This whole discussion about setting our minds on the things of the Spirit versus setting our mind on the things of the flesh, this is not some big game. It's not something that has no real consequences, but rather these matters are matters of life and death. And I think that perhaps is our greatest struggle, if we're to be really honest. If I could add an addendum to last week's message, I would say that. It reminded me of a time of college when our theater department had just put on some plays that, which were maybe considered by many to be somewhat grotesque, unchristian-like, unlike the things of the Spirit. They were things that were put on that that some parents were upset about. They couldn't believe that a Christian university was doing this. And the end of that was that the school decided that they were going to organize a debate between four different professors. They had two professors from the theological department, of which I was majoring in, and they had two professors from the theater department. And they said, we should talk these things through. And I can remember that debate really well, even to this day. On the one side, there was essentially the position that the arts don't really affect us, that they argued that art is just that, it's art. And therefore, it doesn't really matter what's in it and what we consume, what we see in art, it really doesn't do anything to us. If anything, it challenges our position and it challenges our thinking. On the other side of that debate, led by one of my New Testament professors, was a couple of men who said that's not true at all. That the arts do affect us, that what we put into our body has a ramification, that we are in Jesus Christ, we are to be lights of the world, and that lights of the world have no fellowship with darkness, that we disassociate with darkness. And yes, they were saying we certainly engage with lost people as a part of our gospel mission, that we are to go to the ends of the earth, but that we should avoid, we should not subject ourselves and our thinking to darkness in order to accomplish this. In fact, the theater head of our theater department actually made the opposite argument. He said that the Christians should take pride in polluting their minds, so to speak, and going to those things which are of the darkness. In fact, we should do that with regularity so that we know how to win the lost better. And so you can see how that debate played out and how they argued back and forth and so on and so forth. In some ways, that is the debate of Romans 8. It's the debate that continues on to this day. What should the Christian focus his attention on? Is it okay? Is it acceptable to focus on the things of the flesh, those things which are not pleasing to God? And how much of that is acceptable versus how much is not? The heart of that debate, I think, is a question. Just how dangerous are the things of the flesh to our mind? When we talk about this, when Paul talks about it in Romans 8, is it all a game? Is it all serious? Got me thinking this past week as we were at home for Thanksgiving. I don't know how many of you have Netflix in your home, and if you want to judge me as unchristlike because we have Netflix, feel free. This is your moment. But a couple of years ago, we cut the cable cords and we went to streaming sites. So we have Sling, we have Netflix, we have what else? Do we have CBS Sports. You got to have your sports channels, and a few other streaming opportunities. Disney. But anyway. I don't get the opportunity like the rest of the family to spend much time there, but this week, with a little bit of downtime, I hopped on Netflix and I was watching different movies. I'm kind of a hopeless romantic, so I watched a lot of those Hallmark movies and that type of movie, as you might imagine. But as I was scrolling through it, it was interesting what all is available to you. And one section under Netflix was what is trending now, I believe is how it's termed. And you can go through and see hundreds of movies and shows that are trending across the globe on Netflix. And as you scroll on to one of those shows, you get the opportunity to see a 30-second preview or a 15-second preview. Those of you with Netflix, or you're familiar. And as I was scrolling through it, I came across an advertisement for a particular show. And I'm not even going to name that show this morning because I don't want to indulge you and I don't want to glorify sin. But there was a preview for a particular show that I could tell was not Christ-like and was not something I wanted to watch. But the premise of the show is that these people who are all in major financial trouble are rounded up and they are brought together. And some of you have watched the show because I can hear you squirming in your chairs. They are brought together to play a series of children's games like Simon Says, Tug of War, Follow the Leader, so on and so forth. And they think that if they just win at the games, they're going to receive all of this cash. But as they play the games, they find out that failure to win isn't just being eliminated. It's in fact actually a deadly matter. And as I watched that preview, I thought to myself, this is Romans 8. The Squid Game. I had to say it, right? The Squid Game is Romans 8. Because in Romans 8, the Apostle Paul is saying that when we set our minds on the things of the flesh, this isn't something to play around with, but actually, this is something that has eternal consequences. Our culture would say, that's not true. Life is a game where the choices we make have no consequences, but a game where we choose to think on what we choose to invest in, play with, has no real ramification. But Paul wants to declare the exact opposite. The apostle's words could not be more stark. He tells the Christians of Rome that the things of the flesh are not to be meddled with, that they are deadly, that they destroy peace and satisfaction, that they destroy your contentment, that they destroy everything that's life-giving. And then he contrasts it against the things of the Spirit, which he says are life-giving, that they are joyful and they are peaceful. And he wraps it up with this reasoning. The things of the flesh, simply put, don't please God, while the things of the Spirit do please God. Church, man was created to please God. We were created to be his image bearer. And in this moment, Paul is saying that when we don't do that, we can find no real joy and peace. In fact, we find the exact opposite because we have lost our sense of identity and purpose. And what we're left with is death and destruction and decay. So in this battle we fight for the mind, it's one not of just, you know, academic thought or discussion. It's one of great importance. And with that importance defined, Paul then offers his closing thought. And beginning in verse number 9 down to verse number 11, he writes, "You, however, are not in the flesh, but are in the Spirit. If, in fact, the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness." Verse 11, "If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you." I want to make three quick points this morning that will be easy to remember, and do this to the best of my ability to be timely, because this all ties together as we come to the Lord's table today. Number one, Paul begins with our position in Christ. As he looks to wrap up this battle of the mind, he directs us back to who we are in Jesus Christ, our position. He wraps us up in many ways in the same place that he started. This discussion began with a lengthy discussion several weeks ago over the previous two chapters, in chapters 6 and 7. We've talked about it at length already, so I will not belabor the point, but it is critical at this moment that we have been delivered from one dominion into another, that we have been brought from darkness into light, that we have been set free from one master and given to a new master, that we have been set free from the master of sin, and we have been given over by self-sacrifice to the slave of righteousness, that we have been adopted from one family into another, from the family of the evil one, who he was our father, to God's family. And now he returns to that point in these verses. Begin with me in verse number 9. In the first part, he says, "You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit." That is, that you and I are no longer captivated. We are no longer controlled. We are no longer under the impression of the flesh. Those things which do not please God no longer have control over us. We have been united, as it were, with God. And he says that we have been united through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. He goes on to say that the Spirit of God dwells in you. It's an important statement. First, because it defines for us in context when we receive the Spirit of God. I know that many churches like to have this conversation, and there's all of this discussion about second baptisms of the Spirit of God and all of that. But Paul here in Romans 8 builds his theology upon the idea that the Spirit of God is not given to us in portions or in pieces, but that the Spirit of God is given to us at conversion. In other words, when I professed faith in Jesus Christ, I was given the Spirit of God, and that is why I have been set free from the captivity of the evil one, because the Spirit of God lives in me to overcome such temptation. But second, it also shows a mutual abiding. He closes with, "The Spirit of God is dwelling in you," but I want you to notice that he actually opened with that you and I are in the Spirit. Notice that? He begins verse 9 by saying that you and I are in Christ, or in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. So he sees us as both dwelling in the Spirit and the Spirit dwelling in us. Why would he do that? Well, what he's doing in that moment is he's meaning that when you and I have received the Spirit of God, and upon our profession of faith in Jesus Christ, that abiding is without separation or distinction. In other words, we are in each other. I am in him. That means that I am marked for his protection and comfort and care, but also that he is in me, given to me for deliverance, for correction and guidance. That I am in him so that I am declared and protected and comforted, but also that he is in me, that I have received guidance and direction and even correction over the years. But it's more than that. The Spirit of God is my seal. It is my declaration of who I am. How do I know that? because of the adoption papers, so to speak. Look at the second half of verse number 9. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to Him. And the Him is obviously in context God the Father. In the Roman world, status, heritage, and position were everything. And I think Paul draws upon this in this moment. I think he uses his vocabulary in a precise way to draw upon an illustration that these men and women would have understood. In the Roman world, upon request, a person had to have proper documentation with them to state who they were, whether they were slave or free, whether or not they were of certain families or certain prestige. In fact, the consequence of not having such paperwork was actually could be quite deadly for them. And I think he knows this. I think these people know this. This is the illustration that he wants to draw upon. If you applied for a job in the Roman world, or if you wanted to cross certain boundaries into certain provinces, you would be requested to show your heritage, whose you were, where you had come from. Maybe we could think of it in today's terms like carrying an ID with us. Apply for a loan, get a title work done, write a check, whatever it is, but do anything major and you have to provide an identification card and it states who you are and some number by which they may track you down. And even in a distant way, all of that data can be taken back to your family, can be taken back to who your family was through your family name. Or your social security number, as it were. In that number is represented not only your past, but also your present. Tells us about where you've come from, but also tells you about where you are in the present, specifically with debt to asset ratio and so much more. In fact, you may not have known this, but the associated number that you're given through your social security number is related to your wife's family. I didn't know that until we started having kids, and I wondered why they got the certain prefix or first numbers that they, instead of getting the numbers that were related to me. It was because it's associated with your wife's family. It's interesting. So all of that tells a story. It tells about who you are, where you've been, who your family is, and even where you are in the present. Similarly, in Roman culture, people were prepared to present their papers, as it were, upon request. Paul leans into that worldly reality, I think, to declare a spiritual truth. Your papers, beloved, your papers as Christians, as saints of God, your papers are the Spirit of God. He is given to us. Without Him, we are not in the kingdom. We are not citizens of God's house. We are not a part of God's family. Do you see that statement? You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If, in fact, the Spirit of God dwells in you, anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ, he says, does not belong to Him. So the Spirit of God becomes my identification. The Spirit of God becomes my sonship, my daughtership. It tells whose I am and whether or not I'm a part of His kingdom. That point is made clear in other places in the New Testament. Specifically, it's made clear in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30, where he speaks of our identification in God as being important on the final day of judgment. We're told not to grieve the Holy Spirit by whom we have been marked, he says, with a seal for the day of redemption. In other words, he's saying in that moment that the Spirit of God is given to us at conversion until we reach that final estate of glorification, because through the death or the second coming of Jesus Christ, I will be asked to present my identification, and it is the Spirit of God on that day that will testify that I am a part of His family. And so because of that, I'm to live life in a way as not to grieve Him. And His purpose is to testify on our behalf before God, to present our papers, as it were, to show that we are a part of His family. What's interesting, however, is that in Romans 8, the emphasis is on something different. In Ephesians 4, the Spirit of God's testimony, His paperwork, as it were, is our standing before God. But in Romans 8, the subject is not standing before God, but actually the subject is the believer. It's you and I. In other words, the Spirit is not testifying in Romans 8 before God, though He certainly does that. But in Romans 8, The Spirit is actually testifying to somebody else. Who else could He be testifying to? Well, think back with me quickly. Where did all of this discussion begin several weeks ago? It began with a simple question. Why do you and I still struggle with sin?
If I am in Jesus Christ, why do I struggle with sin? Why do I, as Paul said, why do I do the things that I hate, and why do I desire to do things that I do not find the ability to do? Why do I still struggle with sin if I am in Jesus Christ? And to that question, Paul told us to reshape our thinking, to remember the gospel. Romans 8, verse 1, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. He wants us to reshape our thinking, to think about the fact that because of Christ's work on our behalf, that we no longer stand before him as condemned, but we stand before him as justified and holy. And therefore, the subject of our discussion is our own internal struggle, one of the mind. And to that subject, Paul continues to speak, and he does so by speaking about the Spirit's testimony. Who is the Spirit proving my citizenship to? Who is the Spirit proving my familyship to? Who is the Spirit saying to this important message that I am a child of the King? It's to me. In Romans chapter 8, it is the Spirit of God who is speaking to me, saying to me, hey, remember whose you are. And remember that you are not your own any longer, that you are not of the evil one, that you are not of the wrong family, but you have been adopted by the right family. See, beloved, fundamental to my war against sin is my knowledge of who I am. And who am I? Talk about a question that plagues the masses, right? What is my identity? Over and over again, over the years, I've ask this fundamental question of so many folks. What is your identity? If I asked you today to define who you are, what would you say? What would you write down? Well, according to Romans chapter 8, beloved Christians, we are children of the King. And when we forget that, when we doubt that, when we struggle to remember that, the apostle says that the Spirit of God has been given to us to make that testimony clear. What I do today must be consistent with who I am. Who I think I am will be the determination as to what I decide to do. And so he's saying in this moment, reshape your thinking. Yes, remember that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And lest you forget, the Spirit of God has been given to you that he may testify to you over and over again that you are a child of the King, that you are a part of God's marvelous family. So many times we identify who we are with what we do, especially men. I think we are the worst at it. We like to, when we introduce ourselves, we will introduce ourselves by name, and then we will follow up by what we do for a living. And oftentimes that can even carry over to family, right? I had somebody this past week on a visit turn to Isaiah and say, are you going to follow in the family's business? I think he was talking about preaching, and I said, oh my Lord, I hope not, right? Now Zariah maybe, but Isaiah probably not. But it's interesting how oftentimes we get associated, right? We get associated with our family business. For example, if you go to Southern Illinois today, you meet some of the people who knew me when I was younger. Irrevocably, I'm linked to my family name there, that family name of Guffey. And what we did for a living. In fact, growing up, we would always be asked, my brother and I oftentimes, whether we would continue the family business on, whether we would expand, and so on and so forth. In some way, Paul is saying, Christian, will you continue the family business, not only in your own life, but will you have these papers present to be a testimony to say, this is whose I am? The apostles' declaration is one of great importance. I am not my own anymore. I have a new position. I have a new family. And even when I start to doubt that within myself, the Spirit of God is there, like paperwork, to testify of my adoption. That's our position. Then he leads us to second thing, which is our problem. And I'll be especially brief because it's been the summation of the last several weeks by this point. In verse number 10, he writes, but if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. I want to key in on those first two phrases. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin. Constantly juxtaposed against each other, one another, in Romans chapter 8, is the declared work of Jesus Christ. That is, that I have been declared justified, holy and righteous before God. And it's juxtaposed against the reality of a fallen creation, or it's put in contrast against my sin. So the problem, one more time for Paul, is that I have been declared justified. That means that when God looks at me this morning, because of Jesus Christ, that he no longer counts my sin against me. What a great testimony and message. Indeed, he does not even see my sin any longer. When he looks upon me, what he sees is the perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ in my stead. But the reality is that I am still a sinner. And I should have at least gotten an amen there this morning. Living in a sin-sick world, and that means that I still sin, that until I reach glorification, I'm still going to struggle. I should be more like Christ today than I was yesterday, but I'm not yet perfect, nor shall I be until that future that I await. And here, that is the problem. It's outlined one more time in this brief verse. It's outlined one more time. I am in Christ Jesus, and he is in me, right? And he is in me through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, but my body is dead because of sin. In other words, this feeble tent that you see in front of you, this feeble existence, as it were, is still going to struggle with that which doesn't please God because it is dead and it is waiting its future glorification. So the position is, I have been adopted out of one family into a new. I have been brought from the realm of darkness into the realm of his marvelous light. I have been taken from the family of the evil one into the family of God. My problem is that even having been transferred from the family of the evil one into the family of God, I still struggle with wanting to go back to that bad family. I still struggle with wanting to be tempted by sin and its power over me. And so now he gets us to the solution. The solution to the problem is, number three, the power that he's given to me in the Spirit of God. Look at the second half of verse number 10 first. After he has said that my body is dead because of sin, he then says, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Verse 11, if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through the Spirit who dwells in you. Inextricably linked to victory in the war that every believer faces is his or her identification and dwelling with the Spirit of God on a daily basis. It is the Spirit of God who testifies to God. In other words, the Father of the work of Christ experienced at the end. It is the Spirit of God who testifies to me also every day, my citizenship in the kingdom of God. And he's saying that it is the Spirit of God who enables me or empowers me to fight against the flesh, that which is not pleasing to God. I wonder this morning, how mighty is that power at work? Well, Paul even declares that for us. In verse number 10, it gives life to that which is dead. Did you know that you cannot stand before God today and say, I didn't want to sin? I know that I'm in Christ. I didn't want to sin, but I just couldn't help myself. No, Paul says here in verse number 10 that even though the body is dead, the Spirit of God gives life, meaning that the Spirit of God gives you the opportunity, the ability to overcome that temptation. As the New Testament writer would say, that there's no temptation by which that we should be overwhelmed, but God, for where God has provided temptation, he's provided a way of escape. In other words, the power that is in us is powerful enough to raise what is dead to life. It is powerful enough to overcome our inabilities. It is powerful enough to make us stand strong in the things of the Spirit. But it's more than that. In verse number 11, Paul says that it was the exact same power that thundered forth Jesus Christ from the tomb after he'd been dead for 3 days. I really got captivated by that one thought this week. I want you to think about it. Paul is saying in this moment that the power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead after he laid in a tomb for 3 days is the same power that is given to me to fight against sin. Because, here's his logic, here's his reasoning, the Spirit who raised Christ from the dead is the Spirit that God has given to live with you in this life. Just stop and think about the monumental moment or the gravity of such a statement. He is saying in this moment that there is nothing that should overwhelm you, church. There's nothing that should overwhelm you, believer. Yes, we're going to make mistakes. Yes, there's going to be slip-ups. Yes, we're going to still sin as we await that future glorification. But he's saying in this moment that there is a power that is given to you, and it is the power that resurrected Christ from the dead. How much power did that take? That power that rolled the stone away, that raised him to life and to glorious life, to the praise of the Father, that power was exhibited in the Spirit of God, who Paul says has been given to you at conversion, not only to testify on your behalf of whose family you are, but also he's been given to you to set your mind on the things of the Spirit. He's been given to you to overcome any temptation, any trial, any tribulation. I like where he goes next, but I've chosen to leave these words unexhausted in the weeks to come. But if you turn with me to verse 12, if I may read them briefly, it says, "So then, brothers, we are debtors." That's an understatement. I mean, you know what a debtor is? Brother Todd Girlt knows what a debtor is. A debtor is somebody who owes you money, right? A debtor is somebody who has something for which they have received, but they have not given payment. We are debtors, he says, not to the flesh, not to the sinful world, not to things of sin, not to living according to the flesh. In other words, we owe the culture, we owe sin, we owe the evil one absolutely nothing. In fact, he says that if you live by the flesh, you will then die by the flesh. But if you live by the Spirit, put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God, he says, are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Stop there. He's saying in this moment, we are debtors. There is no doubt about that. We have received something for which we cannot pay. But do not be confused as to what that was. We did not receive something from sin. Sin always took away. It brought death. But we have received something from God for which we cannot pay. He says, in that way, we have become debtors. And who is our debtor? Who is our guarantee? It's our Father. And how do we know that we are His? The Spirit of God has been given to us to testify to that reality. What a marvelous truth. So here's the invitation this morning. It's really simple. First, I would say to you that if you are wounded and worn out, if your own mind has given up, if you have even lost your sense of identity, then my first challenge to you this morning would be to check your papers. The apostle lays out the greatest of theological truths. When do you and I receive the Holy Spirit? We get him upon conversion. Upon professing faith in Jesus Christ, believing that what he did on the cross was enough to pay the penalty for my sin, we receive the Holy Spirit, he's saying, as an identification into the family of God. In other words, in simple terms, if you have professed faith in Jesus Christ this morning, start there. You have a new identity. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and behold, all things have become new. If you've trusted in Christ already, perhaps this morning, if you're wounded and worn out and weary, Paul would say, look back, check your papers, remind yourself whose you are. Then I would also say to you who have never trusted in Christ that you don't have the papers. You don't have what we have. And so my encouragement to you would be to get the papers, to get the Spirit of God. And how do you get the Spirit of God? By believing that what Jesus Christ did on the cross of Calvary was good enough to pay the penalty for your sin. Second invitation would be that we would be honest about the problem. We all, beloved, wage the same war today. A war that is between what I have been declared to be justified and what I presently fight, a body of sin. Realize that this war is a literal daily battle. And that the moment I put my attention down, the moment I'm less intentional about it, the moment that I really set my guard down is the moment in which I will fail. And this battle is mostly engaged in our mind. It's fear and doubt over failure. It's a one of struggle between desire to do what pleases God and one of desiring to please me. A war over who is in charge. Paul says that war has been settled. That war has been settled in you, but we have to be honest about that problem. And then third and finally, my encouragement would be tap into the power. You see, the one who raised Jesus Christ from the dead is present and he is able to fight on your behalf. Ask for his help. As Baptists, we have a tendency to be a little bit afraid of the Spirit of God. I'm not
sure why that is. God has given His Spirit to us for monumental moments, for great importance, to testify before Him whose we are, to testify in our own lives who we are, to remind us of the things of Christ. And now Paul gives us another promise in the Spirit, that God has given us His Spirit to wage the war against sin. Would you tap into Him this week? Would you ask for His help? Spirit, change the way I think. Spirit, change the way I do business. Spirit, change the way I talk. Spirit, change the way I view others. That's my invitation this morning. Be honest about the problem. Tap into the power that God has given to us in His Spirit. And if you're wounded and worn out and weary and lost your identity, check your paperwork. See if the Spirit of God doesn't testify on your behalf.